Well, let's just start off by saying STEM's a total hoax, and I'll tell you why. STEM is designed for them. STEM is for them. Because we can have all the technology in the world we want. We can have all the maths, all the engineering. If you don't have the economic understanding of revenue flows and the demands of what people want and building it and bringing it to market, there won't ever be another job.
The best short films for lifelong learning, recommended by teachers for teachers. This is Short Films Teachers Love with your host, Richard Lee.
What do you say to people when they ask you, what do you do?
Now I actually say author.
Right, okay.
But people call me a futurist more often than not, and I'm happy to go with that because they pay more money for futurists. I'm happy to go with it. But look, basically, the truth is I'm a freelancer who teaches people about business and the future. That's really it. And so what I do is I basically put three parts together. Anthropology, that's human behavior. Technology, so that's, you know, what's changing, and then the economics, so what are the numbers, because economic is the modern day scoreboard, right? It's not about money, it's just about how we interact with each other and have social and financial contracts with each other. And so I just mash the three up of those together. Technology is the stuff that changes, and humanity and anthropology is the stuff that doesn't change, our behavior. So you put those two together and you can get an equation of what the future might look like.
Yeah, and that, you know, in some ways a nice segue to you know, thinking about the future requires some creativity, some imagination. So I asked you to pick three short films that have inspired you or affected you along the way. So one of them is called 1 Minute Time Machine.
Excuse me. Do you mind if I...
The short summary of it is there's a guy who comes up, he's sitting on a bench and he's sitting next to a girl and he's got this little 1 minute time machine with him, and he's trying to impress her, and each time he makes a mistake he presses it and he comes back and he keeps getting better and better at
Groundhog Day style.
He keeps getting better at doing it well. I originally liked it because I thought that our lives are a little bit like that. You actually do get more second chances than you think, and the whole idea of school is that don't fail, don't make a mistake, no red pen, get a perfect score or it's over for you. It's over. You'll be eating dog food, brother. Like, that's kind of, they don't say that, but that's how it feels, right?
Yeah.
And this movie made me feel like, actually, life's a little bit more like, you actually get more second chances. So long as it doesn't kill you, you get second chances and you get a lot of them. In fact, every day is another chance, isn't it? You can start today and say, well, I'm not going to follow yesterday's script. And I like that, but it's a little bit dark as well. And I didn't realize that until after.
Hey, you like science?
Science. My 5-year-old niece likes science. I have a doctorate in quantum mechanics.
But it turns out that she's kind of like a physicist as well. And she says to him, you realize that each time you press that, you're dying. So at the other end, it's dying because it's a parallel universe. And then it gets quite quirky at the end, and there's some funny scenes where, like, you know, they show what happened in the past. What happens with technology is we forge ahead, we always go forward, and we're using the technology to go faster into the future, and we tend not to look behind. The externalities usually happen behind and they don't bubble up until much later. It's like a car. The exhaust pipes, you know, probably by design, are at the back. Or maybe because horses had exhaust pipes that are at the back as well. I don't know, right? But you don't see it and you forge ahead, and sometimes because you can't see the externalities or the costs, you know, the pollution coming out of the tailpipe, you can forge ahead without really realizing what the impact is. And then when you get there, you go, oh, God, goodness me, we didn't think of that.
Yeah. And I just think of that every day when I see another smartphone or a kid on a screen all the, you know, the Chinese factories and the environmental costs of this, it must be just, what are we doing? Scary. Let's talk about sight.
Patrick.
Oh, hi, Daphne. How are you? Sorry.
It's okay.
You look great.
Thank you.
I thought it was incredibly well put together. I mean, it was Hollywood-level sci-fi kind of visually. It was very interesting. But I think it's a glimpse into the future of ambient computing. So at the moment, what we've got is technology that requires us to hold it with our hands or interact with it or go to a computer and be on it. We have to. It's like a crying baby. We've got to, you know, hug it and caress it and it beeps in our pocket. Ooh, we've got to play with it, right? It's immature technology. Yeah. And so this is the idea that you'll have contact lenses that have computational abilities and head-up displays and augmented reality instead of a smartphone. And this gentleman, if you can call him that, goes on a date where he's using an app to give him advice on what to do next, you know, with the girl that he's with and things that she likes, and he's Google searching her and all of those things. And it turns out pretty evil, where he's kind of really manipulating her. And I just liked it at first because I thought, wow, this is scary.
Why are you drinking?
What's that? No. A dating app.
No.
Oh, no.
It's for
I
programming.
It's just my luck. A friggin' gay junkie. Disgusting.
Wait.
Do not touch me, you creep.
But I also thought, this is where science fiction becomes really important, because science is a fork in the road, right? And even though the technology is inevitable, how we interact with it isn't. So the technology will forge ahead, and we will have contact lenses and go beyond smartphone and ambient computing. But what we allow to happen legally in the regulatory environment is up to us. How it gets shaped is up to us. It's like occupational health and safety. That wasn't there when the factories first opened. We just chopped off people's arms. Yeah, so sorry about that, Tony. Sorry about that arm. But, you know, we've got to get the Model Ts out, brother. People are waiting to buy them. And so this is that. For me, it's really important that we consider what could happen before it happens so that we can shape it. And so that, for me, was really interesting. It's don't just let the technology be. Shape the technology.
Let's move on to the last film that you chose, called Pixel.
There's an old discarded TV, like a 1980s TV, and bursting outside of the TV are all these pixels, which form the 1980s retro arcade games. So Donkey Kong and Bomb Jack and Pac-Man, and they all go around
Frogger,
and they all eat up a city. And it looks really, it's amazing to watch. And everything turns into little pixels. And in the long run, you know, the whole world becomes pixelated. And I feel like, in a way, it sort of represents the digitization of the world. And then the world actually floating in space turns into a little block, which is cool and funny. But it's almost as though that's when it started, when, you know, in the late 80s, when computers became affordable to everyone and gaming, and then the world's become this big game of computers eating each other and more technology eating itself. But the reason I picked it, in the first instance, the reason I like that is that that turned into a movie. And what I loved is that something small, like a side project, like this Pixel movie, they actually sold the rights to a major Hollywood studio, and there was a movie called Pixel that came out afterwards. But it first started, you know, 6 years ago with this short film that people made. And for me, it said, hey, sometimes funny little cool things that you like can become something far bigger and more important and into a bigger economic opportunity, hence the importance of small projects.
Look how big you've grown.
That's so sweet. He's so sweet.
I know. You're a good boy.
Tell me about then your appreciation of art, obviously, and this is where I've come to see that you are not against art, which is exciting.
Are you going to tell everyone the truth? Come on, tell everyone the truth. What happened? Come on, tell them.
I was having a go at Steve about something that he wrote. It was called the "We Are Losers in the Video Streaming War," and it sounded like Steve is an extreme, beyond the pale economic rationalist who didn't value art. He valued art as just like a series of phone numbers in a great. I don't know how to describe it, but I misread what you had been writing about, because you do appreciate art, don't you?
I love art.
So, well, mate, my bad.
No, that's fine. Every day I do an artistic little heading of as I procrastinate and plan the day. So I absolutely love art. You know, I didn't really like art that much as a kid. It's funny because, you know what? You get put into these categories. Oh, you're good at maths, you're good at sport, you're good at this, you're good at art. And if your art isn't as tasteful as what people appreciate, then you're not an art, you can't draw. And yeah, and actually the idea that drawing is art is crazy, because art's all around us in so many ways. Even the way you treat someone can be an art form, or the way you interact with people. It's interesting because artistic pursuits like movies and music had an inordinate way of making very few people an extraordinary amount of money for a long time, and that system's broken. It's broken. Right, and we're moving away from that idea that you have, you know, a top 40 of music, and if you get a record deal, you're going to get in there, and if you get a number one hit. And that's broken down. Now that's gone into the long tail. And I don't, you know, I don't, even though I think that the music today isn't as good because there aren't the gatekeepers, well, it's too bad, you know. We need to find a new business model. And, you know, if I look at someone like Banksy in the street art, that for me is interesting because there's no barriers to entry, no canvas, no curator, no anything, and you can just go out there and create your own art, and people have started to make a living off something that was a fringe activity. You know, if I look at rap was no resources, no anything, you know, in the Bronx in the 1970s, actually, what have we got? Nothing. We're a record player and a microphone. We're just going to sing and make up our voices, make our instruments, and, you know, do aerosol art and break dancing. And that spawned a multi-billion dollar industry. So we need creativity to actually find tomorrow's business model.
And there's this phrase, I mean, you know, there's a big push these days for STEM, so science, technology, engineering, and maths. But you've got this phrase, ESTEEM, which is, just explain that. That includes some entrepreneurial stuff.
Yeah, well, let's just start off by saying STEM's a total hoax. And I'll tell you why. It's just a hoax. STEM is designed for them. STEM is for them, right? Because STEM is still being subservient and being a cog in their industrial machine. They just worked out that their machine didn't have enough science and engineering and technology and maths in it. So they said, go and learn STEM and we'll still plug you into our machine. ESTEEM is building a machine for yourself because it includes economics and entrepreneurship. Because we can have all the technology in the world we want. We can have all the maths, all the engineering. If you don't have the economic understanding of revenue flows and the demands of what people want and building it and bringing it to market, there won't ever be another job. Right? So we need entrepreneurship and economics. And so that's what I'm about with ESTEEM, is building in the two missing E's. Because without that, you can have garage heroes. And we all know someone who's a great technologist and got this amazing technology in their garage. Well, it's about bringing it to the market. That's where the value gets created.
Good stuff, and all the best for the next book and everything else that you're doing to make this package of your fascinating career more successful.
Thanks, Richard.
To listen to the full conversation, find Short Films Teachers Love on SoundCloud or wherever you get your podcasts. For extra notes or community support, join our Facebook group today. This show is a proud member of the Education Podcast Network. Podcasts for educators, podcasts by educators. To learn more, visit edupodcastnetwork.com.